Dear students, today we are going to discuss the next topic that is relating to witnesses. And till now we studied that certain evidences are going to be treated as primary evidences and some other evidences are going to be treated as secondary evidences. There are documentary evidences and also what not public documents, private documents, and if so, all these things will be submitted to the court in a systematic procedure. And here, whom they are going to question, who may be testified as a witness. To submit all these evidences, a witness is supposed to come to the court as into the witness box as a witness. And who will be the witness? And section 118 of the Indian Evidence Act says that every person is a competent witness unless every person, and all the persons, there is no exemption at all. Every person is a competent witness to testify unless he is unable to answer to those questions with rationality due to his tender age, or maybe because of illness, or maybe because of his old age, or maybe because of some other reasons. Therefore, when he is unable to answer to a question with rationality, then he will be disqualified. Except with this thing, all other persons are eligible. Means what? All other persons means automatically you may get a doubt. What about the children? Till now we are studying about minors and their rights and all other things. Minor also can be a witness according to section 118. But there are certain conditions to be taken into consideration. In time and again, in different kinds of cases, Supreme Court reiterated that a minor can be a witness, but sometimes some children, most of the children actually, are not in a position to answer all the questions properly. They believe whatever they saw with their eyes and they themselves comes to a conclusion about happening and not happening of an incident. While coming to a conclusion like this, sometimes they imagine certain matters and they will see what they cannot see actually. Because of that, if it is proved that their statements are basing on the imaginary things and they are not having the complete authority to answer before the court, there their evidence is not going to be taken into consideration. And how to decide this? In a given case, when the child witness comes into the witness box, court also will testify that person and will then decide. Means for each and every case, this definition of admissibility is going to be changed. In certain cases, they may be accepted, and in some other cases, their evidence will be rejected basing on their capability to answer. In that particular given case, the position of that particular child is going to be taken into consideration, particularly his mental status, whether he is capable of answering the questions. For example, when a child saw the death of her mother in front of her eyes, and immediately she ran to police and expressed that my father killed my mother. Here there is a lot of evidentiary value to that statement made by the child. Without any kind of hesitation, she said it, and then she will be testified again in the court, and if there also she speaks strongly, her evidence is going to be admitted. And like that only, if you take the example of rape cases, where this minor child becomes a victim particularly, and when she is explaining the trauma which she undergone during that particular heinous act, if she explains with authority and there is nothing to prevent the court from admitting it as a valid evidence, and basing on her evidence, the accused may be punished also. Like that only in some other cases, interestingly, in this case, that victim herself is a minor and she is giving the evidence. In some other cases, victim is a minor and she was taken away by the accused forcefully from a playground where she is playing with some other children. And then at that place, when the other children who witnessed all these things are authoritatively coming to court, and police failed to produce any other evidence except the evidence of these children. In this case also, court held that there is nothing to prevent these children from giving the evidence because they are the best witnesses to that particular thing which has happened in front of their eyes. And they are confidently giving the evidence in the court. Basing on that evidence, conviction was given to that accused in that case also. Therefore, when a child is giving the evidence, The main criteria is rationality, whether he can understand the thing, his maturity levels will be taken into consideration, and if he is having that full confidence in giving the answers, then his evidence is going to be taken into consideration. Like that only, when a child saw the murder attempt on his mother, he saw the attempt and somebody came there and killed his mother, and after seeing it, he went back and he slept. And no complaint from him about this incident to anybody. Later on, when his evidence was recorded, the court rejected that, saying that his behavior is abnormal. Can a child be like that? The moment he saw it, he will shout and he will cry, he will try to run away from that area, or he will try to go nearer to his mother. Nothing is done by him. As it is a casual thing, he saw it and he left that place and went back to sleep. This shows that he is not an ordinary child, so his evidence is not reliable. Like that only in some other cases, when even though the student is 8th class student only, his evidence is admitted because he is giving answers with rationality. And in that way only, when a small child of an age of tender years, I mean 6 years old girl, was raped by somebody, and after coming to home, she explained the entire incident to mother. And basing on that statement, when trial conducted, court held that it is believable. And 11 years old boy, when deposed about an incident which occurred 3 years back, when he is recollecting everything properly and he is answering to the questions perfectly, court held that there is no need to doubt his evidence. And when the evidence is admitted, in all these cases, if you observe, the most important criteria is, for each and every case, the definition of admissibility is changing, basing on the condition and capacity of the child, first thing. And his maturity levels are going to be taken into consideration by testing his way of expression, his understanding, and all other things. So, for case to case, this thing is varying, first one. Second thing, when the same person is submitted an affidavit, chief affidavit before the court, it is held that this chief affidavit is not admissible as per the act. Oath act is there. According to that act, he cannot take any oath even though it is a matrimonial issue. Therefore, chief affidavits are not admitted by the court, but the statements made by the children in the court are admitted basing on these particular conditions. So, when you understood this point, next come to the second doubt. What is that? You will think about whom? Which is going in? Definitely you are thinking about the second one, unsounded people. Unsoundness of mind means what? What is unsoundness? Nothing but a kind of mental disturbance which may be there in the person from the beginning to end of his life. One kind of people. And some other people like us, whenever we get some kind of tension, and with that tension we forget the incidents easily, and sometimes later we may recollect. And some people will be ghazni, they remember, sometimes they will forget. Whenever he recollects the things, he will write on the board or paper, and they, again when he forget about those things, he will do something like, can you say my name, can you remember these things, ila endukana antaru ante, these all are known as, even though they are appears to be movies and other things, in real life these things are happening because lunatic intervals. Certain people, due to medicines or due to some other conditions, at a particular stage they will be having mental problem, and later they will become normal. Some periodical mental problems will come to them, and for some other people, because of medicines they will be normal. When they are not taking the medicines, again they become abnormal. Therefore, in these conditions, if it is proved before the court that the person who is deposing before the court is in a mentally fit condition at the time of watching that particular incident which he is now explaining in the court, and presently also if he is mentally fit, then his evidence is going to be admitted. Otherwise, his evidence is not having any kind of evidentiary value. And the next point which you are going to ask the doubts relating to is, next time, whose evidence you are not going to believe? Is there any creditworthiness? People who cannot speak, when people who cannot understand, hear, people who cannot watch. So physically they are having some problems. Physically challenged persons are there. These persons, when coming to the witness box as a witness, what to do? Even though they are physically challenged persons, they are having that capability to answer to these questions because they censored them, and with the help of an interpreter, 100% they are having the evidence value. With the help of an interpreter, their evidence is going to be recorded, and it will be valid evidence. They are having the right to testify as a witness in the cases. The only problem comes with them is that they cannot express verbally, as they are taking the help of some other aid, and through that they are deposing before the court. Now, if you come to the next point, that is relating to the special communication, the most biggest problem forever is that the communication between wife and husband, whether a wife can be a witness against husband, whether a husband can be a witness against the wife. Either spouse is having that capability to testify against the other party in both civil cases and criminal cases. There is absolutely no bar to take their evidences against each other. And remember this section 120, because section 120 says that in civil proceedings, the parties to the suit are competent witnesses, and they can bring the plaintiff and defendant, they can bring the wife and husband as into the witness box, and the same is about a criminal case also. If so, what is going to happen in the section 122? We will read when that section comes. In the meantime, we will go to the next section, that is section 121. This is also a kind of privileged communication only, because when we face this so many times in the life, when we enter the court as a witness, when we explain everything to the judge, when everything is happening before the judge, we think so many times, often we think that why judge is not speaking anything, why judge is so silent, judge knows everything, we deposit before the judge only, but now they are saying it is not recorded. Step of doubts you are getting continuously. The reason behind this is you are thinking that judge is the witness to your case. Can he be a witness to your case? Definitely judges or magistrates are competent witnesses only, but they cannot depose, you cannot demand them to depose on behalf of any particular incident which is occurring before them, unless they themselves voluntarily comes to the witness box and explain if there is any strong reason to do so, or if there is an order from the higher authorities. Therefore, whenever a particular trial is taking place before them, if a person is fraudulently behaving something and he is doing some other acts, even though judges watching it, they are not going to be the witness. You cannot ask a judge to see this person is submitting false evidence, so you are the witness to my case, I will write your name as a witness. If the false statement is taken before me, means then what will you do? Immediately I will take the help of me, and you will submit before the court to see so and so person saw that false statements is prepared by so and so person, take the evidence. That thing you cannot do when a judge, it so happens at the time of conducting the trial by a judge. But if they themselves voluntarily will come, or an order from the higher authorities, basing on the situations, if there is a complaint against the incidents that taken place in the court or other things comes, then the higher authorities may ask for an explanation from the judge. There he may be a competent witness. And in some other conditions, if he wants to waive off this privilege, then also in most of the cases, almost even matrimonial cases everywhere, when a privileged communication is given, it can be waived off. And if they voluntarily comes to the witness box, then they can come. Otherwise, you cannot compel a judge to come to the witness box. Okay? Now, next come to the section 122. From 122 onwards, all the sections are dealing with different kinds of privileged communications. What is meant by privileged communication? Here, you will get this doubt generally, because what is meant by privileged communication? It is any communication with some kind of trust on the other person. You are disclosing, thinking that they are not going to reveal these particular facts before anybody else. And you cannot break that particular trust and you are binding 100% binding by the trust, particularly if you are enjoying any kind of relation with the party who is revealing those secrets, communications to you, basing on that particular relation. One of those relations is matrimonial relation. Already in section 120 we studied that either spouse can be a witness in the cases, competent witness. That's what we studied. If so, when a wife is coming to the witness box in criminal cases against her husband, if you bring a wife to the witness box and ask her to depose against the husband, can you do it? Yes, 100% you can call the wife as a witness to a criminal case. But the only thing is, you cannot ask her to reveal the facts which she came to know through her husband. When husband himself is giving the information to her, that information you cannot ask her. Suppose every day husband comes to home at night 7 o'clock and till morning 6 o'clock he is sleeping in the house. But on that particular day when he committed the offense, at 7 o'clock he came to home, he moved around the house with lot of anxiety. Later he not even took his meals, and at about 12 o'clock he left the home, and after 2 hours he came back to house and he went to a room and he locked the room for a lot of time. Later at morning 5 o'clock he met his wife and he told her that I committed a murder, I killed somebody. Here this is the deposition of a wife. Out of this deposition, everything is admissible except that word, I murdered somebody, because that is the only point she received from her husband. It is a communication received from her husband. Apart from that, the entire thing is of her own understanding. By seeing her husband, by observing his daily routine work, she compared this abnormal behavior with that routine work, and she herself came to a conclusion about the happening or not happening of an incident, and the same thing she is reposing before the court. Hence, her evidence related to all the other things is admissible, except this particular point is not going to be admitted. Okay, like that only. When so many persons jointly committed an offense, fortunately or unfortunately, one of the big accused's wife is there at that particular place and she noticed everything. She observed that thing and she cannot be a competent witness. We cannot force her to come to the witness box and depose against these persons for which she is the eyewitness. Hence, and in certain conditions, here also waiving of the right, where both the parties are having an understanding and are ready to waive off this particular rights, there they are at liberty to do so on their own. And now, because we are saying wife and husband, if we complete this particular topic with that only criminal cases, it is incomplete, 100% incomplete, because that is the base for the society. They are the base for our Hindu law and our family laws, Muslim law, Christian law, for everything. Their relation is based, because whenever they are fighting with each other, they will enter into the court as a witness against each other into witness box. So when there is a breaking of marriage, wife wants to make allegations against her husband, can she? Yes, because their wife and husband, when they are coming into the court, into the witness box to depose against each other, they are permitted to depose against each other. But no third person can depose. Suppose if your father-in-law wants to prove the defamatory statements made by his son-in-law against him, which he heard through his daughter, he cannot use them. Because here, the son-in-law is deposing before the wife his, all those statements. Therefore, they cannot be admitted by the father-in-law. And in this matter also, actually, Varghese case is there. Later, it is overruled by the all the other previous judgments related to this privileged communication. And like that only, when a wife wants to use any particular communication made in between wife and husband in the cases, or a husband wants to use the communication, they are at liberty. At the same time, when it comes to the video recordings, the rule is a slight little bit changing. There, what the law says is, when you are recording the communication statements or any video scenes of your other spouse without their permission, it amounts to violation of fundamental rights. and their personal liberty is going to be affected. Hence, that type of recordings, if you want to bring to the court as a witness, then those recordings are not at all valid. Therefore, think twice before. Nowadays, it became a common phenomenon in all the cases. Either wife or husband are coming to me, and whenever they are approaching, they are coming with a lot of video recordings, cell phone recordings, and they are showing, see how my wife behaving, how my husband is behaving. Now, you yourself tell me, basing on evidence that no one wants, if any wife and husband comes to you, and if they show any video recordings or audio recordings to you, you immediately ask them whether you recorded it with her knowledge or not. Without knowledge, if anything is recorded in matrimonial issues, those recordings are not going to be a valid evidence. Okay, I think you understood this point also very clearly, and let us go to the next point now.